Hello, Year 7. My name is Miss Davies and I'm the subject leader for English here at Worthing High, and I will also be the form tutor for 7H2 on Wednesdays. And I'm going to be reading the last two chapters of A Good Day for Climbing Trees with you. And we're going to start on page 141. Chapter 18, An Invisible Tree. Late that afternoon, I went to the park. "Where are you going?" a suspicious Donovan wanted to know when he saw me sneaking out the front door. "Mum said I had to make sure you don't get up to something crazy again." I promised him I wasn't planning to go and sit in the tree. The park was deserted when I got there. Everyone had left. Killer and the students, the choir, the cyclists, the pretty girl who had asked for my autograph, and the tree. The municipality had been there. Redface and Ratface had done their job. In a way, I had expected that, but it was still a shock to see the stump sticking out of the ground. Once, when I was 7 or 8 years old, I was in the play area at McDonald's and I saw a woman who had no arm, only a stump. The woman must have seen me staring at it because she walked up to me and asked with a really friendly smile, "Do you want to feel it?" I got such a fright that I started to cry hysterically and ran away to my parents. For weeks afterwards, I had nightmares about the woman's pink stump. That was what the tree stump looked like something you couldn't stop staring at, but that you were too scared to touch. A few leaves were lying on the ground. That was all that remained of the tree. I was no longer 7 or 8 years old. I was 13. Next year, I would go on to high school. I no longer cried about everything. But the burning pain in my chest was so bad, it felt as if I was going to suffocate. I clenched my teeth and my fists. It was stupid. I didn't know why I wanted to cry. It was just a stupid bloody tree. Thousands and thousands of them were chopped down every day, and no one ever shed a tear about that. "A tree should be forever," said a voice behind me. I quickly wiped my eyes. The caretaker appeared beside me, but I didn't look at him. "But nothing on this earth is forever," he continued in a soothing voice. "What's more important is that you and Layla make sure the tree was really seen. In today's world, that's more necessary than you think, to be noticed. Too many trees and animals and people have become invisible or have simply disappeared without anyone remembering them." For a moment, he put his hand on my shoulder. "You and Layla are welcome to pop in for coffee any time." Then Uncle John turned around and walked back to the bowling green. I let out a deep breath and stared at the sawn-off stump sticking out of the ground. I thought of Mr. Fowry, who said I had a rich imagination, and I thought of what the caretaker had just said. Maybe I could imagine that the tree had only become invisible. I pictured a rough, thick trunk growing out of the sawn-off stump. The trunk grew taller and taller and taller. From the trunk sprouted thick, low branches, close to each other, the kind of branches that are perfect to teach a little girl how to climb a tree. The trunk reached high into the sky, higher and higher and higher, until it made you dizzy to look at it. It split into smaller and smaller branches. The tree was exploding into leaves. Birds came to sit on the branches, chirping and twittering. The wind rustled in the leaves. The rough bark was basking in the afternoon sun. And somewhere on the bark, in a secret place among the leaves, appeared a heart with two letters inside it. I smiled. Below the last composition in my exercise book, Mr. Fowry had written, "Keep writing such good compositions. I'm going to miss your talent next year." I got 95% for that composition. I hoped that the following year I would get a chance to write a composition about a tree that appeared out of the ground. It would be a good composition, I knew it. The caretaker was right. It was great to be noticed, even if it was only because you wrote good compositions. At that moment, I thought I understood why Mrs. Merriman had dyed her hair pink, wore pink clothes and walked from house to house to collect money for the SPCA. Why Joy shaved her head, had her nose pierced and became Killer. Maybe I even understood why Mum spent so much time on her very important court case. Why Dad wanted a bigger sign for his shop. Why Adrian had been thinking up clever plans to make money since he was small. It was to be noticed. I smiled. It actually made sense. Okay, except maybe for Adrian. He was probably a boring money grabber. It was no fun always being Marnus in the middle. The one who wasn't a good swimmer, didn't have hordes of girlfriends and wasn't allergic to schoolwork. The one who couldn't read fluently at the age of 5 and wasn't constantly busy with all kinds of money-making plans. I thought I'd finally worked out what made me sit in the tree with Layla in the first place. Most importantly, I thought, I understood why Layla had started a petition to save the tree. Sometimes you need to be noticed, even if it's by your own dad. Marnus! I swung around in surprise when the caretaker called out my name. He had stopped some distance away from me and he turned around. Can I tell you a secret? I nodded. That first evening, your mum came to look for me at the bowling green. She offered me money to keep an eye on you and Layla all the time. I refused to take the money, but I promised her to take good care of both of you both. I could see she was terribly worried about you. I couldn't believe my ears. So that was why the caretaker would come every evening and sit under the tree with Layla and her mum and me. And that was why he brought us coffee and looked so angry when it seemed like things were getting out of control with the students. I smiled. My family was weird. Merry Christmas to you, Marnus, said the caretaker. Oh yes, I almost forgot to tell you. Mrs. Merriman sends her regards. She invited me to have lunch with her on Christmas Day. He turned around and walked off. The caretaker might be old, but it was my... The caretaker might be old, but was it my imagination? Or had his eyes just sparkled the way Donovan's did when he spoke of Melissa? Merry Christmas, Uncle John, I called. Chapter 19, Green Leaves. Number 9 Begonia Street wasn't far from the park. Fortunately, Junior de Twat had asked Layla her surname for his newspaper article, otherwise I wouldn't have been able to look up their address in the phone directory the previous night. The house looked almost as I'd imagined it would. It had a sunny porch covered in purple flowers. I was sure Layla would know the name of the plant with the purple flowers. The lawn was in need of mowing. In a sunny spot on the porch sat a ginger cat, who looked at me through lazy, half-open eyes as I pressed the buzzer at the gate. I waited for quite a while, but no one opened the door. Disappointed, I turned around, but then, out of the corner of my eye, I saw a curtain move. Layla, I called. At first, I thought she was going to ignore me, but then the front door opened. Layla walked to the gate. She was wearing shorts and a light green t-shirt, and she was barefoot. Her hair was tied up in a ponytail. Hello, Marnus, she said. I expected her to be angry, but she sounded quite friendly. By then I had learned one thing. Even though I hadn't known her for that long, with Layla, you never knew exactly what to expect. How did you know where I live? I shrugged. I knew it was within walking distance of the park, and I've read the odd spy story, so I've picked up some tips. She smiled. I cleared my throat. I guess you saw, I mean, the tree. She just nodded. That morning her eyes looked even bluer. I'm sorry, I said. Layla shook her head. It isn't your fault. Things got a bit out of hand. You want to come inside? I'm busy packing, but you can quickly come for a cool drink if you want. We don't have organic fruit juice here, but there's Coke in the fridge. There was a slight reproach in her voice, but I could hear that she was actually joking. That freaking Nature's Gift cold drink tasted like dishwashing water, I muttered. So, are you going on holiday? She nodded. My mum and I are going to spend Christmas with my seaside granny. And after that, I'm going away with my dad for a few days. She said, as if it was the most normal thing on earth. It's probably high time I got to know my stepmother and little stepbrother. I bent down and picked up the blue plastic bag at my feet. Then I'm just in time, I said. This is for you. Merry Christmas, even though it's still 4 days away. On the way there, people had stared at me strangely. I guess they didn't often see someone walking 3 blocks carrying a tree with a red ribbon tied around its trunk. But what the heck? It wasn't exactly the strangest thing I had done in the past few days. Layla unlocked the gate and took the small tree from me. A white kauri, she said. Scientific name, Rhus pendulina. I pretended to be clever. I hope you have space in the garden. The man at the nursery said they grow very fast, but you'll still have to wait a few years before it's big enough to climb into. You're never too old to climb a tree, said Layla with a smile. She caressed the leaves of the tree and looked at me, cocking her head. Marnus, do you remember what you asked me that first day when you opened the door with the dishcloth in your hand? Embarrassed, I cleared my throat. I asked whether you were there for kissing lessons. Unexpectedly, she leaned forward and kissed me. It was just a quick kiss that merely brushed my lips, but my heart started doing strange things in my chest. The sun suddenly felt much warmer on my face and shoulders. The wind gently ruffled my hair, and a tingling sensation went through my arms and legs, as if, at any moment, leaves and blossoms would sprout from my body. And that, Year 7, is the end. I really hope you've enjoyed reading A Good Day for Climbing Trees with all of us, and we can't wait for you to get here in September so that we can talk to you all about the book. And enjoy the rest of your summer.